Hey, as we get started here with our message this morning, remember we're in that series War Room. Would you like watch this clip from the movie War Room?
I just don't understand why you treat me this way. When I told you what happened with my job, I expected you to hit the ceiling there. So in my mind, I was ready to defend myself. Except this time I can't. I hate saying this, but I deserve to get fired. I was deceiving them, and I was deceiving you. I almost cheated on you, Liz. I thought about it. I almost did it. But you know all this. And you're still here. Then I see your closet. And the way you're praying for me. Why would you do that? When you see the type of man I become.
Because I'm not done with us. I will fight for our marriage. But I've learned that my contentment can't come from you. Tony, I love you. But I am his before I'm yours. And because I love Jesus, I'm staying right here.
I'm sorry, Liz. I ask God to forgive me. I need you to forgive me. I don't want you to quit on me, Liz.
I forgive you. I forgive you.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Lord.
We're in our second week of our series that we're calling War Room, where we're talking about prayer. And that powerful movie clip that we just watched illustrates some of the essential teachings that are found in the Lord's Prayer. And if we're going to pray powerfully, that we must have honesty, sincerity, transparency, and the willingness to seek forgiveness and to offer forgiveness to those around us. War Room is a great movie because of the great truth that it is built upon, that prayer changes lives. Jesus knew how powerful prayer was going to be for all the centuries until he comes back, how powerful it's going to be. And so he taught us how to pray in several different places. He knew that people would turn to God in prayer even before they would ever come to church. I cited the George Barna study last week that said that 81% of Americans admit to have prayed in the last week. And that's compared to 33% saying that only 33% said they attended church in the last year. And during the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus took the time to teach his disciples how to pray. And we looked at this passage of Scripture last week, and that's where we're going to go right back to today. So if you want to turn in your Bibles to Matthew 6, 5 through 13, that's where we're going to be. You know, the Lord's Prayer, as it is called, but it's actually our prayer. It's our prayer. If we want to pray like Jesus, if we want to have effective, life-changing prayer. Let's go back to Matthew 6 and pick up with verse 5 again. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. You know, so Jesus said the reward for a hypocrite's full prayer is that pat on the back. The people say, wow, he sure knows how to pray. But as far as a reward from God, he said it doesn't come. Verse 6, but when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So there is a reward to prayer. Verse 7, and when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Prayer isn't about, we said this last week, prayer isn't about wearing God down to your side, trying to convince him to your side. It says he's already your loving Father. He already sees what you need. He just needs you to talk to him, to be in contact with him. Verse 9, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Verse 11, and this is where we didn't spend much time last week. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Now, we used this diagram last week to kind of break down the prayer, how it can be divided into three parts. And we talk about declare God's greatness. It's talking about our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, how great he is. Surrender your will. When we said your will be done, not my will. You know, and then we're going to move into acknowledge your dependence. And we came up, we said if you'll take those first three letters, DSA, it's a great way to remember about praying. Don't start off asking. Spend some time doing these other things. Declare God's greatness. You know, if we'll just spend some time thinking about what a God he is, who we're getting to talk to. That he is the creator of the universe, he's the sustainer of life, the giver of life, and that should humble us, that we're getting the opportunity to talk to him. And that effect should affect us in that next part where we surrender our will. Because there's always going to be the battle of our wills. There's going to be his kingdom and our little kingdom. And we spend, after we see how big God is, and we spend some time surrendering our will, that was if we put his will above our will, his kingdom above our kingdom. And then that's where we move into this third part, acknowledge your dependence. And this is where we didn't spend much time last week. But this is a part of the design of God's design for prayer, so we don't need to overlook it. You know, sometimes it can get overshadowed because we're talking about the greatness of God and surrendering our wills, and then we move into just asking God for things. The hope is after we spent time looking at the glory of God and then we surrender ourselves to him that it will shape how we pray this third part. So let's look at this. He says in verse 11, give us today our daily bread. And that's just a prayer of provision. Bread is the universal symbol and stands for food, for the necessities of life, the things that we need to survive. And some people make the mistake. We usually go one of two ways here. We either spend all of our time asking for things from God, or by the time we get to this, we dismiss this and say, well, this is not important. God's glory and talking about God is more important. Surrender my will is more important. And we dismiss this. And some even think it's noble on their part to do that. But if we do this, we're not praying the way God told us to pray. God wants us to share these things with him. You see, as long as we keep God involved in every part of our life, even the early down to the daily needs, if we keep him involved in that, that will keep us balanced. That'll keep us humble. That'll keep us focused on the things that are most important. And that's what God wants us to see in our lives. But let me ask you this, and be real honest with yourself. Don't say it out loud, but just be real honest. How many of you would be satisfied with just enough for today? How many of us pray this and actually mean it? Just give me enough food to live on today, Lord. Or if you're praying it at night, give me enough food to eat tomorrow. How satisfied with God would we actually be if we looked in our cupboards and we looked in our billfolds and pocketbooks and saw enough money to eat one more day? How grumpy would we be if that's what we saw? See, most of us are not thinking about today or even tomorrow. We're thinking a year down the road. We're thinking, God, give me enough for a good vacation. Give me enough for the kids' college education. Give me enough for the 401k. Give me enough that I can eat out when I want to and still have all these other things. This is some of the greatest words, in my opinion, that were ever written to describe the balance that we need with God on this. Proverbs 30:8-9. Proverbs 30:8-9 says this: keep falsehood. And what the writer's doing, he says, God, I got two things I want to ask you. One, keep falsehood and lies far from me. He says, I don't want to be a liar. And two, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of my God. Is that awesome words or what? Is that an awesome balance on what to live your life by? You know, but how many of us really pray that and mean it? Have any of us ever prayed and said, Lord, please don't let me get that promotion at work. Please don't let them give me a big raise this year. That's the last thing I need is more money. None of us do. Because our nature is to always want more. Remember our study we did on Be Rich back in October? We talked about that's the dirty little secret about being rich. We never think we get there. So we keep trying and trying and building, and all of that time and all that attention is being taken away from God. And that's why he says, find your balance here, that knowing that you have a loving Father that's going to take care of your needs. And then you don't have to focus so much on your needs. Just make them be known to God. All right, let's look at verse 12. He says, forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. Now this you can say is a prayer of pardon. But this is the scariest 11-word sentence that I think you'll come upon. This is scary. One we better not say or take very lightly unless you mean it. You remember the story of David and Bathsheba? That Old Testament story where David commits adultery with Bathsheba, and then she gets pregnant and he wants to cover it up, so he has her husband killed on the battlefield to cover everything up. He takes her as his wife. He thinks everything's covered up, everything's fine. But God sees it. And God sends Nathan, his prophet, to David and says, David, I want to tell you a story. So there was a man who owned thousands of sheep. He was wealthy as he could be. And there was a man who lived next to him who just had one little lamb, and he loved that lamb. Well, somebody come to visit the rich man, and he wanted to throw a feast, but instead of taking one of the thousands of sheep he had and slaughtering it, he goes next door, takes the one lamb that this man loved, and kills it and prepares it for the meal. It says David just goes, he becomes incensed with anger. He says, that man should be killed for what he's done. It's at that point Nathan says, David, you are that man. And he points out the hypocrisy of his sin. He said, you could have had any woman in all of Israel, all the wives of the king, but you took the one wife of this one man. Jesus is telling us that this prayer is no different. The prayer convicts us of our own hypocrisy if we have not forgiven others while at the same time asking God to forgive us. When we pray this, we are saying, and here's why it's so dangerous, God, forgive me to the same measure I've forgiven others. And that's why it's so dangerous. Do you want to stand before your God in heaven and say, judge me with forgiveness the way I've forgiven other people? Is that how you want to stand before God? It's dangerous. Jesus tells it a little different later on. He tells the story of the unmerciful servant, the man who owed a tremendous amount of money to his master. He comes in and he begs him for forgiveness. He said, and he couldn't repay that big debt. He says, give me time. And he lets him go, forgives him, lets him go. This servant goes right out and finds another man who owes him just a little bit of money, has him thrown in prison. The word gets back to the master. He calls that servant in, and he says, because you were not willing to forgive, I'm not going to forgive you your debt. He has him thrown in prison. And the story ends this way in Matthew 18:35. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. See, we are family. God is the Father. He calls us his children. That makes us brothers and sisters. Makes us brothers and sisters. And he has called us to get along with each other. And you can't get along unless you're willing to forgive. It just doesn't happen. We must forgive. Because you can't be right with the Father if you're not right with the brothers and sisters. And right now, we're all thinking of one or two or three things. Some of you are thinking of, I need to forgive so-and-so. Or I need to go to so-and-so and ask their forgiveness. And then there's some of us who are sitting here thinking of a way I can dismiss this and not make it apply to me. God doesn't know what he did to me. God doesn't know what she did to me. He wouldn't ask me to forgive if he knew. But just know this. You cannot dismiss the words of God. And he says we must forgive. That's what this prayer is about. He's talking about staying right with the Father by staying right with your brothers and sisters. One more part here. Verse 13. He says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And this is a prayer for protection. This is another one of those short sentences that's a real gut check for us. Do you really want to be delivered from evil? Do you really want to be delivered from sin? And I've wrestled with this question, thought about it so much over the years. Do I really want the protection of God so much? Do I really want to be protected from sin? Or do I want to be protected from the consequences of sin? I want to dabble with it, and I want to get close to it, and I don't want to enjoy it, but I just don't want to get caught. I don't want it to bring me down. I don't want to be embarrassed in public. I don't want those things, but do I really want that? Do I really want to be delivered from sin and evil? Or I just want to miss the consequences? Francis Chan tells the story of a friend of his who had, and parents, I'm sure you've gone through this many times, but he has a 12-year-old son, and the son just keeps making bad decisions right after the other. And he's so flabbergasted with his son that he sets him down one last time, and he gets a piece of paper, and he says, son, why do you keep making choices like this? Why do you keep making the bad choices? He draws this little diagram, and he says, he jots down things on there. He says, you could choose to do good, or you can choose to go to the bad side. You can choose to go towards God or go towards evil, the devil. And he just writes down these things. And he says, but why do you keep doing the bad things and making these choices? It makes your mother unhappy. It makes me unhappy. It makes me want to fuss at you. And we go through this stuff all the time. You're in trouble, and it's all of this stuff. Why do you keep doing this? And the 12-year-old son says, well, Dad, you're partially right. And he takes the paper and spins it around. He says, Dad, this is the way I see it. He says, I'm going along through life, and I come to those places where I got to make a decision. But it's always easier to make the bad decision, to go after the evil side. He says, it's easier. It's kind of downhill. It's easy. It's always harder to make the right choice. He says, and then when I start down that bad side, the further I get, and I make more bad decisions, the further I get down that way, and I look, and I see it's so far to go to get back on the right one. I got to climb all the way back up to do what's right. And so I always make the wrong decision. That's at the point that you want to hug your 12-year-old son and you want to pop him in the back of the head at the same time. But isn't that perfect? Isn't that a perfect illustration of our battle with sin? That it's always easier to choose the wrong. And it's always going to be harder to go the right way. Jesus is saying in this prayer, he says, if you seek me, if you come to me, and if you really mean this, he said, I'll protect you. I'll protect you from all of these things. I will save you if you will come to me. You know, we pray in Jesus' name. We sing songs about Jesus. But have you ever stopped and thought what Jesus' name actually means? What his name means? When the angel spoke to Joseph and explained to him what was about to take place with Mary being pregnant, he said this in Matthew 1:21. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Jesus means the Lord saves. The Lord saves. And I know, and you know it, as we read through here, all through the Bible, and we see God's plan, and he says, I'm here to forgive you. I'm here to save you from the penalty of sin. I'm here to wash you white as snow. But do you realize he also says, I can save you from your sins. Not just the effect of the sin. I can save you from it. If you'll come to me, that's what this prayer is. If you'll come to me, I can save you from all the heartache and all the bad decisions that goes with sin. That's hard for us to imagine here, living in the country that we live in with level, flat ground. But just imagine that it's a little more hilly, mountainous country we lived in. And there's a cliff in our town, in our county. And on a fairly regular basis, somebody falls off that cliff. You know, the humane thing to do and the Christian thing we do is that we would send the ambulances to the bottom of the cliff to pick up these people and get them to the hospital and get them back to health. And if it started happening so often, we begin to just park an ambulance down there ready for the next person that falls off. That would be a humane thing to do. But if we really cared, we'd go to the top of the cliff and we'd put up warning signs and we'd put up a fence. And Jesus has done both. He says, I'll save you when you fall, but I can save you from falling. You don't have to keep repeating this over and over. You don't have to keep taking this great fall and going through all the pain and all the suffering of that. That's what this prayer is, that he can do that. Lord, I don't want to sin like this anymore. Now, as Eric comes and the band gets ready, I want you to just look at this prayer. When you look up at the Lord's Prayer, what do you see? Is it just some words? Is it something you recite every once in a while at a special occasion when the speaker or somebody on will ask everybody to repeat the Lord's Prayer with me? Do you see it as the avenue of getting what you want from God? Or do you see it for what it was really meant to be, as the way it will change our lives? The way it will put us perfectly in tune with God and deal with all of the issues that we have. This is genius, y'all. This short prayer is genius because it deals with everything we face. It deals with everything. And if we can pray this way, if we can live by this way, not reciting the words, but praying the words, it'll change us. It'll change this church. It'll change our community. And if enough people, it would change our country, our world. So today we're left with this. What do you do with Jesus' model for prayer?